Look, it's been around 6 weeks since Donald Trump was shot in the face, and almost killed on live television. And what have we learnt today? A bit about the gunman's search history, as well as a photograph of a backpack and some information that doesn't really tell us anything about what the heck actually happened that day and how on earth the Secret Service failed so badly to keep Donald Trump safe. Now, it's interesting, Donald Trump has praised the people who kept him safe that day, but he was a little bit more critical during this interview with Dr. Phil.
You know, when this happened, people would ask, whose fault is it? I think to a certain extent it's Biden's fault and Harris's fault. And I'm the opponent. Look, they were weaponizing government against me. They brought in the whole DOJ to try and get me. They weren't too interested in my health and safety. They were making it very difficult to have proper staffing in terms of Secret Service.
Amanda, is he right? What do you make of what he had to say?
I think he's right. And the thing is, they always say America's the leaders of the free world and, you know, it's a safe country. And then something like that happens. And then there's this confusion over how and who and what. But yes, it is the responsibility administration. But it is such a setup. And I have what worries me is so many things are happening in plain sight right now, right on live TV. And then people will just say, oh, no, it was an accident. Oh, no, it was that person over there, and just walk away. We as a people need to push harder and question more. I think we've been desensitised. I think we've been just give up, especially during COVID when we tried to push and ask questions. People said, just don't bother, you'll get hated on. I think we need to bring that back. We need to push harder and say, well, no, that's an unacceptable response from the government. We want to know more. It can't be what it looks like. There needs to be more there.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. It's just wild to me that he was almost killed 6 weeks ago, and so many people just want to forget that it ever happened. We can just focus on TikToks for Kamala Harris. Yeah. Look, massive news over the weekend as we witnessed a Kennedy endorse Donald Trump. RFK Jr. says that he wants to make America healthy again after he dropped out of the race and, of course, lost his Secret Service protection. But he says that he and Donald Trump will investigate corruption in regulatory agencies while addressing the rise in chronic diseases in the United States. What do you make of his move?
Look, I love it, but what he's up against are the pharmaceutical companies, which a majority which are just, you know, pushing drugs to make money, right? And the government's usually involved in that, saying, yes, 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 we'll support that, or we'll make sure that that legislation gets through. So he's going to be fighting a lot of people within government, a lot of large companies that have pretty much gotten away with a lot. So he's taken them to court. I think people have forgotten that. RFK has a reputation of taking pharmaceutical companies and other big corporations who ruin the environment to court and won. So if he's coming in, that's who he'll target. And they're the ones that usually don't like being targeted and can react in a very vicious way. So I'm all for it, and I think it's great. Maybe this is the turning point that everyone's prayed for, that we might have a focus back on healthy lifestyle, healthy eating, healthy mental health, you know, bring back hope, bring back the small business, bring back the family unit to work together as a community. That would be refreshing.
Well, the left-wing media has been in meltdown over RFK Jr.'s endorsement of Donald Trump, and they haven't even tried to hide it. Just take a look at CNN cutting off its live coverage of RFK Jr. as soon as he mentioned that Kamala Harris hasn't done an interview.
They would be astonished to learn of a Democratic Party presidential nominee who, like Vice President Harris, has not appeared in a single interview or an unscripted encounter with voters for 35 days.
We've been listening to independent candidate Robert F. Kennedy Jr. from Phoenix outlining what led him to his quixotic quest for the White House.
Oh, interesting timing. And here's CNN's commentary of the historic event.
This was cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. And trying to get any logic out of that is good luck with that. Because it's, one, you can't understand what he says. Two, if you can, you can't understand what he says. And I'm reminded of a line of in Mel Brooks's Blazing Saddles, when somebody gets up and gives an indecipherable speech, he says, who can argue with that? That's authentic frontier gibberish. And that's exactly what that is.
Amanda, are you surprised?
Not surprised, but you know what's really annoying? These are grown men, right? Willing to follow a really foolish script to keep their job, to push it, something that's just, I mean, the language is actually just so ridiculous. Are they threatened by RFK's truth or his masculinity? I don't know what it is, but grow up and speak the truth or say nothing at all.
Yeah, I think they're threatened by the truth.
Absolutely.
You just listen to what RFK Jr. had to say. It was such a powerful speech.
Simple. The truth is always so simple, yet it scares so many people. Maybe it should be an opportunity for people to say, OK, whether I like or dislike the guy, he
maybe listen.
Yeah, listen. And it's OK to change what you originally thought because you were potentially brainwashed by the propaganda that Facebook just admitted that they allowed.
Yeah.